black clouds in your, and you're like, Lord, what are we supposed to do with this?
Right.
So when you can come in, and I can say just a few things that we say, hey, we need to be baptized in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
We need to feel His Spirit, experience His love, His mercy. We need to, all of those things, it feels like home to us.
Yeah.
What I'm just coming from, and maybe we're being recorded, and I don't want to shine a negative light on a congregation that we're stepping into out there in those
right.
that city of Andrews Air Force Base, but it is very different.
Yeah.
You get chaplains from all denominations, serving the same group of people, let me tell you, there's mixed messages.
Yeah.
There's a struggle, and so I just want to say before I start, our kids, Heidi and Hudson, keep them in your prayers. I know y'all love children. Keep my wife in your prayers. This is new for us.
Yeah.
I mean, we were at home in Texas. She was born and raised in that church. She never had to leave. I got the Holy Ghost in that church when I had one strike on my arm. And God brought me through college and seminary and ordination, and now I'm preaching the gospel. Now I'm in a place where it's it's all right.
Yeah.
It's all right. I'm excited. And so I'm going to get right into it. I've got a lesson. And so at first I thought we were going to have a translator. I thought that was so unique coming here that we had that. I had never seen it as a regular
place
like
it really is.
We're in a place, I know you know this, there's millions of people around us. Seven, eight pickup trucks at a red light. That's 5 o'clock traffic in Wichita Falls. Now it's like, I don't know if there's a time of the day, I was like, this is the city that never sleeps. Never went out where there's no traffic. But I had a young man right before I left. It's a man that I heard the time of the day. And he talked about coming up here to the D.C. area, and he talked about the story of Paul standing before King Agrippa. And it really made me think, and so some of the notes, some of the things that I have right here is some things that I feel like my family is stepping into, but I know it's a word for us today, because
Amen.
If all we had to do was say, I'm going to serve Jesus and feel His presence, shed a few tears, raise my hands, and walk out, and that's all there was to it.
Right.
We got that part down.
Amen.
So I just want to say today, if you feel like there's a struggle in your spirit to keep serving God, you feel like, man, how come all these other Christian faith groups do they struggle like I'm struggling to really feel like I need to connect? That's God refining you.
Yes.
The other ones are just resisting God altogether.
Yeah.
I
want
to say you need to keep on.
Hallelujah.
Let that struggle be there. We know where the answer is. It's a battle of our will, kind of getting there. So let me just read a quick verse. It's Festus interrupting Paul as he's standing there shackled, giving an account, Acts 26:24-30. And as he thus spake for himself, Festus said with a loud voice, Paul, thou art beside thyself. Much learning doth make thee mad. But he said, I'm not mad, most noble Festus, but speak forth the words of truth and soberness. For the king knoweth of these things, before whom also I speak freely. For I am persuaded that none of these things are hidden from him. For this thing was not done in a corner. King Agrippa, believest thou the prophets? I know that thou believest. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. And Paul said, I would to God that not only thou, but also all that hear me this day, were both almost and altogether such as I am, except these bonds. And when he had thus spoken, the king rose up, and the governor and Bernice, and they sat with them, and they that sat with them. Basically, they got up and they walked out.
Yeah.
So I want to talk just a little bit about it. It's a kind of a sermon. It's kind of a lesson. It's just something that I've kind of had, and I tried to bring some of this morning in our congregation out on the base. But what we have here are basically three different attitudes towards Jesus.
Right.
Three different attitudes towards responding to what God's calling us to respond to. So we've got an almost Christian and an all-in Christian. And so I think God put that part on my heart for a theme for our congregation out there on the base. So here's an extension of that.
Amen.
Congregation.
Amen.
If God will, we're all in.
Yeah.
I'm not almost.
Amen.
I'm all in.
Yeah.
So you can be seated, get nice and comfortable. I wish there was popcorn and soda pop.
I don't think so.
So we got 10. All right, here we go. So we got three different attitudes. Let's look at old Festus. What a name. Yeah. I'd be disgruntled too. Here's one that represents a hate towards Jesus. He has an antagonistic attitude towards the gospel. He's accusing Paul of being crazy. He's like, you're smart, you're learned, you've got education, and you've lost it. You don't know what you're talking about. Isn't it funny that you can pursue sports, you can pursue your place of employment, you can pursue all sorts of things in this world, and really, we're open to anything nowadays in our life, but you know what? You say that I'm sold out to Jesus, and you're going to be shamed for it.
Right.
You say, I'm sold out to the kingdom of God. I'm sold out to pursuing a relationship with the Almighty. And now people think you're crazy.
Yeah.
Isn't it weird how that works? There's something that just doesn't allow for a freedom to pursue God.
Yeah.
You can sell everything, sell your kids, and pursue this, and everyone thinks it's honorable. It's interesting. That Festus spirit is in our world today. Then we've got Paul on the other side of that coin. He honors the Lord. He says, this is how I'm giving you a testimony. I'm bound up, I'm shackled, I'm scarred for the sake of the gospel. Maybe none of us have to literally face it, though I know people in our world are dealing with literal scars and bruises and condemnation and oppression. But we feel it a lot of times just in our spirit. Leave a worship service and go to a store downtown and you can just feel it. It feels like it hurts just to be around our world sometimes. How can they make me without the message of the gospel? How can they not have access like I have access to Him? Then we've got the third part, and I'll raise my hand with you. We all have sat on this one.
Yes.
We've all at times in our life been an almost Christian. And we need to be an all-in Christian. I could feel that theme from the first time we met. That we came in here, that it was the guy, I can't remember his name, but he went and preached to a stadium of people. Like the next week, I'm like, man, that dude just preached in the auditorium. That was pretty awesome. He stepped in and was like, we got the best of the best. So we've got this guy that's holding out, King Agrippa. He's holding out. For some reason, things kept him on the verge of going from almost to all in. And so that's what I want to talk just a little bit about today. There's just a little context of attitudes that we see that face a person when we can, whether it's in the middle of a church service, whether we hear a Christian song on the radio, someone comes to share their testimony. It's not just one thing. It's an all-inclusive whenever we're faced with a decision to be made. I had an old pastor that told me this. It was so simple, but it's so true. If you live for God hard, it's easy. If you live for God easy, it's hard. It's almost. It's sitting on the fence. And I know I've, if you've literally sat on the fence, it hurts. It's uncomfortable. Nothing's right. So verse 26 says almost. And that's where we find this king. He's almost a Christian, but he's still lost. He's almost ready to commit, but he won't commit. Now, I'm not talking about the first time we came to Jesus. I think this applies to each day that we live. Apply that to Sunday, if you will, or Wednesday, or home group night, whatever night that may be. We're faced with, are we going to be almost, or are we going to be all in? So what brought him to this place of being almost? What almost convinced this king to be all in? First, we see there's a testimony in the scriptures. Paul reminds Agrippa of the word of God, and he tells him that he both knows these things and believes these things. I mean, he tells him this. What things are we talking about? The things contained in the law and the prophets. Paul is using the Bible as a tool to bring him to faith.
Amen.
If there's a time where you're ever struggling, I had a preacher buddy tell me, if you're ever at a loss for words, when there's no words to be said, just preach the word of God.
Amen.
Just read the word of God, and that'll fill in all the places where you're at. The word of God, when you feel like, I do not know how to connect with this person. They don't look like me. They don't vote like me. They don't talk like me.
Yeah.
They're a completely different side of the coin than I am.
Yeah.
But God's called me into their life.
Yeah.
Use the word of God, and that can be used as a powerful testimony. Why does the word of God, why is it necessary? I just want to go through a few examples of it, because the Bible tells us that it is the word of God that reveals God's glory and shows us our sinfulness. It shows us who we are. It shows us our need of salvation. James 1:23, the Bible is a mirror and it shines its light on man's sin. James 1:23, the Bible is a sharp two-edged sword.
Thank you.
To the very heart of a man. Hebrews 4:12, the Bible is like a hammer. It can crush the hardest heart. The Bible is a fire. It can cause the coldest heart to burn for God. It's a tremendous, powerful book, and we must hear it to respond to it. Romans 10:17 says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God.
Amen.
This brought him to a place of being almost the word of God. Not only was there that, there was a testimony of a saint that stood right before him. Here's Paul standing before him, giving this testimony. The whole chapter is devoted to Paul telling Agrippa how to be saved. There's a whole, from the time you enter into Bible college, there was a whole, just years and years of telling people how to be saved. And I'm like, how in the world can these guys with letters before and after their names miss this?
Yeah.
I've seen 8-year-olds with tears flowing and hands raised receiving Spirit. But there's a confusion on this testimony. So Paul is sitting there giving them what he had received. He didn't make it up. He didn't give them anything extra. You can it really gets real if you're sitting there in handcuffs. I don't know if you've ever been. You don't have to go back, you know, what's covered under the blood. But it makes you stop and think a minute.
Yeah.
Maybe I need to think about where I'm at. Here's this man standing there literally in bonds and chains, handcuffed, and he's sharing the testimony. There's nothing more powerful.
Man.
You want people to be drawn, don't be afraid to use the word of God.
Yes.
You want people to feel like, man, this person really has something to say. Get real with them.
Yeah.
That's all right.
Yeah.
I preached not too long ago and talked about how a lot of times people pray and they want God to completely heal them of their wounds.
Mm.
No scars, no visible evidence.
Right.
But if you've ever had a wound and a cut and damage done to your flesh, there's a time in the healing process where the air has to hit it.
Yeah.
Where it's got to be exposed. And you know what happens when it's exposed? People are going to ask.
Yeah.
People are going to be like, what happened there?
Right.
We want to hide it. But you know what? For us to be truly healed,
we've
got to have our testimony. Wherever God will help you come.
Yeah. This mic doesn't sound like this.
We cannot shy away from that. Really. When we do it, it's like,
I
really want to talk to this person. I don't want to share really what happened to me. What in the world? Mm-hmm. If you can't tell them your story, that's the power. It's your story. No one can take that from you. No one could deny what Paul was telling them on that day, standing before him. Not only did he have the testimony of Paul at that moment, not only did he have the testimony of using the word of God, he also had the testimony of Jesus Christ, the testimony of what Jesus did for him. He reminds them, hey, what was going on? What happened? It wasn't done in some corner. It wasn't done behind closed doors. It wasn't some religion that cropped up, that started over here. It was done out in the open.
Oh, yeah.
So everyone could see. Undeniable that everyone could see. He tells them, you know what Jesus did. You know who he is and what he did. Everyone knows that Jesus died. Everyone knows that he rose again. What happened with that earth-shattering day where all the masses in the congregation was there? It's not that it was hidden. He talks about that day and reminds him. I don't know about you, but if you can think of the first time you ever felt that welling up inside and the tears started flowing before you even got to the altar of repentance, it was the testimony of our Savior that did that. Imagine the crowds. Imagine their cursing. They're taunting him. You see Jesus as he's hanging there. You see the bruises. You see the bleeding. Can you see him as he speaks right there in that moment? As in the middle of all that, he's not lashing out, but he's praying for you by name. And he's offering forgiveness by name. Can you comprehend that truth? That everything he endured, the nails, the beating, the embarrassment, the spit, everything he did for you, that's what moves us.
Thank you, Jesus.
That's what changes us. We cannot discount that. That part cannot be removed.
Hallelujah.
So when you see somebody getting to that place of almost versus all in, There's either one or a combination of those three, a testimony of the scripture, a testimony of someone giving it, of the saint of God, of the one that's been filled and willing to share it, and then that testimony of the Savior. That's what brings us to this place.
Right.
Now, as they say, where the rubber meets the road. Is that a Texas slang, where the rubber meets the road? Have you heard that before?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Well, what in the world kept this person at that place, this king, from being all in? What kept him at being almost? I don't know what your status is, what your signature block looks like, what your pay grade is, but I'm going to tell you that as a person, I believe all of us are stuck at that almost because of these two things. One, the power of sin. And two, the power of self.
Yes.
The power of sin and the power of self. It's easy to blend in big church, little church, kind of do it and kind of sneak on out. But when we really want to change, when we are desperate for God in our life, there's some things that we have to get through.
Yeah.
And we have to call out something that needs to be called out. There's no one that can approach the throne without that honesty that this is where I'm at. It's wrong. I failed you, God. I need your mercy.
Yes.
And we hide it and just say, well, if I compare myself to other people, I think I'll be about mid-range on the target.
Right.
If it's just about that, but it's never about a comparison to other people.
Right.
It's about hearing the word, hearing the testimony.
Thank you, Jesus. Yes.
And really obeying it and saying, you know what? This is where I've got to be. This is what I have to change in my life. And it's different for all people. It's easy to call out the typical ones that maybe you grew up with. It's like, if you don't do this, 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 and this, you're good. But I tell you what, in the world that we live in, it seems like it's so dynamic. How can we be a Christian? How can we serve? Sometimes it's like all we got to do is just have a little bit of light. And I'm telling you, you know, just a little bit of light, the darker it gets, the more the light shines. I know that we can, as a congregation, as individuals, we have to address this in our life. And so here we see this man at almost, first and foremost, the power of sin in his life. In verse 30 and also in Acts 25:23, there's a woman by the name of Bernice mentioned. Agrippa's living with her as if she was his wife. They're living together. She's actually his sister.
It's messed up.
Immoral. We'll just call it that. So here he is in this immoral relationship. And I don't know about you, as the word of God is going forward, as the testimony is going forward, we start this bartering with God. There's this feeling that I'm going to have to start making some change. I'm going to have to start giving up some stuff if I'm going to be all in. And this is where he was. I'm going to have to give up this relationship. He was so addicted to his sin that it kept him at almost and not all in. The power of sin, we cannot underestimate it. Your flesh will betray you whenever it can.
Yes.
The flesh, every day, is warring with the spirit.
Yes.
Every time you say, Lord, I need to come to that deeper place, the flesh is going to find some way to revolt.
Yes.
If I got kids, all right, y'all, brush your teeth, go to bed. Part that kind of plagues us back here. As soon as we say we're going to do it, here comes that real friendly gentle 4-year-old that says, do it later. It can happen later. It doesn't have to be now. The power of sin is what keeps us from taking that step. And maybe it's just splitting hairs. I know I'm coming from hearing other chaplains that you got to sin a little bit every day. That's what God's mercy is for. I really think it's a mindset.
Yeah.
You know, I know our flesh is weak, and I know the Spirit is willing to serve and to reach out and to connect with God. I think it's a mindset. If you step onto that field, size them up, man, they're bigger, they're going to beat us. You're probably going to lose.
Yeah.
You step on that field, we're going to win.
Yeah.
We're going to take this. We can't just say, oh, well, God saved me. I'm in the right church now. Everything's going good. And, you know, I'm not going to have any more battles. If anything, you've been born. And if you look at a newborn baby, that's kind of where the journey begins.
Yeah.
We're all on a journey, whether you've been serving God 20 years or 20 minutes.
Yeah.
There is a battle that goes on with us every day to be almost or all in.
All right.
And sin has a way of keeping us. I don't know about you, but the only way that I can find true victory over sin, and some you may be able to, I can tell you the ones that were going to kill me, wasting a paycheck in one night in Dallas, Texas, God took that desire from me, and it was gone. Other things that are just as wrong, I feel like I've had to battle to this very moment, like it's this, trying to get through it. But
right.
I'm telling you what, if you make up your mind that I'm all in,
it's
always.
Yes.
Yes. Amen.
It's a beautiful word.
So the power of sin, that's one thing. We like to just kick that over there and say, bad. We know it. One of those things like the pink elephant in the room. Where's the other one? The power of self. Everyone say self. Point at yourself.
Self.
Take a selfie. The power of self. Here we go. It wasn't just the sin in the messed up relationship that he was in. The power of self accompanied that. First, he was concerned about his position. The position that he held. What position do you hold today? That if you really were to be one of those Christians to sell out and give everything, is it going to hurt your status? Perceived. Whether you're doing this job, it really doesn't matter. Our position, who we think we are, messes with us. So here's Agrippa, being a king, he could say, oh man, I'm going to take the message and the testimony of this prisoner right here, and I'm going to bow to Jesus Christ. We've got his Jewish subjects over here. We've got his Roman superiors over here. They would have turned on. Have you ever felt like if I really make a stand here, it's going to turn on me? The situation might turn on me? I don't know about you, but I feel like each one of these examples I'm going to give, I've been on this side of the fence and this side of the fence. And I would always prefer to do what's right, to profess the name of Jesus, to allow myself to just say, you know what, make up my mind, I'm going to do it. It doesn't matter what I think. It doesn't matter what I think I should be doing right now. This is what I feel in my spirit to do, and I've got to obey it. God blesses that. Over here, all we do is we're justifying, and we're looking for excuses.
Right.
We're saying, well, it's all these other, well, I would have had it been for this, or I could have, if this would have been like that. That's excuse land. But I don't know about you, if you've ever been a Christian and lived in excuse land, it's miserable. It's like riding in the back seat of the car, being motion sick, lactose intolerant, with only no drink. It's not fun. It's not comfortable. I don't like excuse land, and we tend to wander into excuse land every time we wake up our eyes and we start living in our day, on how we choose to live our day. Not only was it his position, next it was his pride. We've got this other guy who was very antagonistic towards the gospel, a dude named Festus. I'm like, what do you got to prove to Festus? I mean, his name is Festus. But here we go. If he would have accepted Jesus, listened to Paul's testimony, he would have lost face before this man at that moment. He couldn't allow this guy who needed the gospel so much to see him I'm going to respond to this man's testimony, and I'm going to bow. And many times, folded arms, that resistance that happens. Maybe you have a guest that you've won. You can tell they're kind of in that mode of, all right, they're having to decide. This is it. This is it. And God wants them saved more than you could ever imagine, more than you could ever want to go and pray for them.
Yeah.
That person and their own pride is what has to go.
Yes.
I had a preacher buddy tell me, he's like, Eddie, you're your own worst enemy.
Yeah.
I'm like, I am my own worst enemy. Because you know what? I live in this flesh and I've got to deal with my own pride and my own thoughts and my own ego and my own what I think is best and my own. I don't want to pick my battles. I put my foot down here and next thing you know, I've done more damage.
Yeah.
And I'm apologizing and I'm having to repent to people and to God.
Yeah.
Like, that's what God saved me from. Yeah. Why am I going to bring that into this life? Lord, I've got to get out of the way. I've got to get out of the way and I've got to allow you to deal with me in that moment.